talk about the new cinema movement in Chile, which emerged around the 1960s and early 70s in this Latin American country. As a film movement, new cinema was part of a revolutionary struggle that was taking place within Chilean society and popular culture at the time. As a country, Chile is marked by stark inequality in terms of the distribution of wealth and private property. And this was created through colonial rule, the Spanish colonial rule to be precise, which ended in this country around 1818. However, post-independence, the conditions that created such inequalities weren't remedied. As a result, a minority elite had control over the vast natural resources of the country, as well as more than half the arable land in the nation. And the majority of the population had no say whatsoever on the economy or the political structure, you know, of the country, and were effectively disenfranchised. In the 20th century, we see that the US government had a major influence over the economic and political policies of the country. And this was because of the fact that US corporations were investing and extracting the natural reserves of Chile in the form of copper or nitrate. And the kind of extraction that was being done was a major drain of wealth on Chile, with the natural reserves being drained and exploited by these foreign corporations with the aid of the national oligarchy, of course, without a simultaneous development of the national infrastructure as well. The kind of extraction and exploitation can be aptly illustrated through this quote that I will now read out from Eduardo Galeano's book, Open Veins of Latin America, where Galeano writes, "In 1969, Anaconda had garnered $79 million in profits from Chile, the equivalent of 80% of its global profits, although its investment in Chile was less than one-sixth its total investments abroad." Anaconda, of course, was a U.S. mining corporation that was exploiting the copper reserves of Chile. The U.S. government, of course, was keen on protecting the conditions which allowed such exploitation, and they therefore exercised, through the CIA, through economic and political advisors to the Chilean national government, maintained a certain stronghold over the nation's economy and politics. Now, at the end of the 1950s, in 1959, the success of the Cuban Revolution provided an impetus to popular struggles across Latin America. And in Chile, there was a sense of optimism that a socialist, democratic path to socialism could be possible. This was led by the figure of Salvador Allende, of course, who, with his leftist alliance, which was called the Unidad Popular, which was trying to come into power through electoral campaigns through the 1960s. Which finally would culminate in him being democratically elected in 1970 and the Unidad Popular, or the Popular Unity Government, coming into power. In the realm of cinema, we see that while films were being made in Chile from the time of the silent era, these films were heavily influenced by Hollywood. Hollywood was the major cinematic influence in Chile, and this was problematic at two levels. Firstly, through Hollywood, the Chilean audience was being exposed to a vision of modernity that was did not bear a relation to the experience of the vast majority of the Chilean population. And secondly, through these films of Hollywood, the Chilean spectators were being exposed to an idea of progress or development, which was basically a manifestation of the neo-imperialist view of the world as held by the United States. Thus, this influence of Hollywood was a major factor within the realm of cultural imperialism exercised by the US in Chile. In the 1960s, there emerged a new generation of filmmakers in Chile, and this was primarily made possible through the film department established by Sergio Bravo in Universidad de Chile, or the Chilean University, called the Center for Experimental Films. And filmmakers such as Raúl Ruiz, Miguel Litín, Aldo Francia, and of course Patricio Guzmán were making films. In 1967, there was a film festival held at Viña del Mar, where Latin American filmmakers across the continent, they came, and this film festival provided a platform for the viewing of films from different countries of Latin America. At this festival, Aldo Francia made a very interesting comment. He said, "There can be no Chilean view of Latin American cinema for the simple reason that we do not see here cinema from Latin America. Through the festival, we know that Latin American cinema is one of debate, a cinema of struggle." Thus, a new idea of what cinema should be, what national cinema should be for Latin American countries, was emerging. And previously, due to the fact that there weren't other forms of cinema made available to the public, such alternative forms of filmmaking were not thought to be possible. But suddenly, filmmakers were experimenting, and they showed a different kind of commitment with regards to working under situations that were very difficult in terms of scarcity of resources. And through the period of 1968 and 69, five very significant films would emerge in Chile. These were Raúl Ruiz's Tres Tristes Tigres, Three Sad Tigers, Elbio Soto's Caliche Sangriento, Bloody Nitrate, Aldo Francia's Valparaiso Mi Amor, Valparaiso My Love, Miguel Litín's El Chacal de Nahuel Toro, The Jackal of Nahuel Toro, and Carlos El César's Los Testigos, or The Witnesses. Of these five films, four in fact were made one after another using the same camera. This is an illustration of the kind of commitment that these filmmakers had in making a different kind of national cinema, which would voice the issues that pertained to the Chilean reality and become a part of a larger project of cultural liberation. The project of cultural liberation and the role that cinema would play in that was part of the Popular Unity government's program. And this Salvador Allende mentions in his program of the Unidad Popular, where he says, "The national system of popular culture will be particularly concerned with the development of the film industry and with the preparation of special programs for the mass communication media." Now, following the coming to power of the Popular Unity government, Miguel Litín was appointed as the director of the Chile Films. Now, what was the Chile Films? In the 1940s, the state government, recognizing that film industry could be a very potentially lucrative industry, established the Chile Films. But it was an overambitious project, since the lack of a national tradition of filmmaking resulted in a lack of national projects. Thus, this institution, this establishment, was turned into a bureaucratic institution which could hardly be sustained. Litín found it very difficult to work within this bureaucratic institution, and within 10 months he had resigned. However, it was also not possible to create an alternative infrastructure for production and distribution, and this was because of the scarcity of resources that Chile was suffering from in the 1970s. This was because of an invisible blockade on the country that had been organized by the United States government in an effort to topple the government of Salvador Allende and stop the socialist revolution from happening. Now, however, Raúl Ruiz, for instance, made several films through the period of 1970 up to 1973, when a military coup, which was sponsored by the CIA, ended the popular unity government, Raul Ruiz produced a number of films, of which The Penal Colony, for instance, is a film that deals with the themes of torture and military dictatorships, which would become part of the Chilean reality soon after the fall of the Allende government. Miguel Littin at that time was working on a very ambitious project, a film called The Promised Land, La Tierra Prometida, the post-production of which he completed in Havana, Cuba. It was shown at the Berlin Film Festival. However, Littin was never able to show this film to the audience he had made it for, which was the Chilean people undergoing a socialist revolution. The film mixes history with allegory and legends and myths to create an extraordinary vision of Chilean history and the Chilean people. It is set during the 1932 Socialist Republic of Chile, which was an 11-day long socialist revolution that took place in the country and which most people in Chile don't even remember. The film, on one hand, follows the socialist revolution that is taking place in the government, and at the same time also follows a group of landless peasants and unemployed workers who, led by a peasant leader called Jose Duran, is trying to catch up with the forces of revolution as they traverse across the physical geography, the physical landscape of Chile. Now, the landscape which the film traverses or journeys across is not only the physical geographical landscape of Chile, but it also has a mythic element to it, and thus it's also a landscape of memory, a landscape of the past which these people are journeying across. And what the film effectively does is create a history of Chile, which is a history of brutal repressions of popular struggle of the people by the military, by the army. And this was a warning for the Chilean people, who themselves were experiencing a revolution, that their revolution too was vulnerable. And that they needed to develop strategies to tackle the opposition, the right-wing opposition. However, this film never came to being, but today it is an important document in the sense that it also creates a different notion of the history of Chile, which is suppressed by the dominant classes, that is erased from the public memory. And Miguel Littin, in an interview, says regarding this different view of history that usually the reading of history is manipulated by political and economic interests of the dominant class. People in general have no idea of change except the mere impression of a cloud that passes by. For example, if you ask the Chileans about the socialist revolution of 1932, few people will be able to tell you anything because they have no memory of it. The youth of our country grow up without any real historical awareness or any deep sense of cultural identity specific to itself. Personally, I have always believed that a country which does not have a past can neither have a present nor a future. Now, this desire to recover the history that is lost from our memory, to review the past, to bring out the revolutionary elements of the past, was one that is shared by other filmmakers belonging to this movement, notably Patricio Guzman, who is a documentary filmmaker. Through his films, has tried to repeatedly recover a past which has been forgotten or distorted by the dominant classes. Patricio Guzman was working on a documentary project during the Allende years, which culminated in the film La Batalla de Chile, or The Battle of Chile. Now, post-military coup, what happened in Chile was that an extremely repressive dictatorship took over, led by Augusto Pinochet, and thousands of people were rounded off and killed or tortured and then killed. And the people were disappeared, their bodies were never found. In fact, Jorge Muller and Carmen Bueno are two notable film personalities connected to film and the new cinema movement who were disappeared. Muller worked with Guzman as a cameraman in La Batalla de Chile, and Carmen Bueno was the lead protagonist or the lead actress in The Promised Land by Miguel Littin. Now, other filmmakers such as Littin or Guzman went into exile. La Batalla de Chile, for instance, was completed in Cuba where Patricio Guzman was living in exile. This film then became an important document of the socialist revolution, because post the military dictatorship, post-establishment of military dictatorship in Chile, what happened was a fierce campaign of repression of any memory of the Salvador Allende years was undertaken. And thus, this film then became an important document of what was happening in Chile that needed to be suppressed. After the return of democracy to the country, these filmmakers also returned and Guzman's documentaries have obstinately tried to recover that past, which has been erased, or a very determined effort has been taken to erase that past. Now, we shall look at two clips. The first clip is from The Promised Land, which is, and in this scene, we find a very allegorical depiction of the socialist revolution, where the train that you will see is actually a symbol of the capitalist notion of progress, which has been halted by the revolution, and how the different classes are actually reacting to this revolution. The following clip that you will see now is from a documentary called Chile, The Obstinate Memory, which was made by Patricio Guzman after he returned to Chile once democracy had been established. And this scene particularly brings out the poignancy and the tragic nature of the failure of the socialist revolution led by the Popular Unity Government.
Por primera vez en el centro de Santiago, después de 23 años, resuenan los acordes del Venceremos, el himno de la Unidad Popular. Su autor, Sergio Ortega, que vive exiliado en París, nos ha enviado la partitura y una banda de jóvenes aceptó tocarla, para gran sorpresa de la gente.
Ma'am, I just want to know, how did the military dictatorship affect the development of new cinema as a movement?
As a movement, the dictatorship ended the way it was developing. However, the filmmakers such as Miguel Letin, Raul Ruiz, Patricio Guzman, all went into exile and they continued to make films, and their experience of the socialist revolution and the vision that was held by the film movement continued to inspire and inform their work. And Litin, for instance, made films in Mexico and Nicaragua post going into exile.
Ma'am, could you please tell me that what was the roles of the films of the new cinema movement during the period of the military dictatorship?
The dictatorship in Chile as well as the United States government had launched a fierce campaign to discredit the Salvador Allende years of Chile, and this and also distort facts. Thus, the films from the new cinema movement played a very important role in providing the global audience, as well as those from Chile who were now living in exile, a vision or a view of the past that was authentic. And this also helped in rallying support for the protests against the dictatorship of Pinochet, and as well as aiding the campaign against the human rights abuse that was taking place in Chile under the military dictatorship. Thank you.
Thank you.